Welcome to our Sunday sermon. It is the 29th of October, 2023, and we are going to be in Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this time. We ask you to bless our lesson today. Let us be inspired by it, Lord. Let us also be convicted by it, Lord, if that be your will. I pray if anybody listens to this that does not know you personally as their Lord and Savior, that Father, through the scriptures today, they might be drawn to you, Lord, and might want to investigate more about a relationship with you. Father, bless our time as we study in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, we're going to get right into this. Colossians chapter 1. Paul gets into some of the practical messaging of this chapter. He started the first couple chapters with a kind of a theological lesson of who Christ is. If you look at chapter 1, verse 15, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of creation. Verse 17 of chapter 1, he is before all things. And he starts this theme at the end of verse 18 that in all things he may have preeminence. And so some of the teaching that was going on in this area, this region, was kind of diminishing Christ. John the Baptist said of Jesus that he must increase and I must decrease. And Paul says that for me to live is to live in Christ. And this is really what the theme is. And it's the theme of today's lesson also. And that is to lift and exalt Christ in our lives. In verse 21 of chapter 1, we talked about the idea of who you are. You are alienated enemies in your minds by wicked works, yet now he is reconciled. So Christ is all in all. He is preeminent. And we are those who were reconciled to God through Jesus Christ. That's the message of salvation. Romans 3:23, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, no, not one. There's none who seeketh after God. There's none who doeth good. Romans 5, because of one man's sin, Adam, in the Garden of Eden, sin is passed to all men. So we would all agree that none of us are perfect. We're all flawed. And Romans 6:23 says the wages or the payment of that sin is death. And but the gift of God is eternal life. So you have this payment weighing on the human race of the penalty for sin, which is death or separation from God from eternity. But Romans 5:8 says God demonstrates his love towards us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So we have the picture of because of Adam's sin, sin is passed to all men. We're born sinners. None of us are perfect. Because of that, the wages or the penalty or the consequences of our sin is to be separated from God for eternity. But God, who was perfect, came, Philippians 2, made himself of no reputation and came in the form of a man and became obedient unto death, even death on the cross. So he came and on this cross, he died for us, paid for our sins, was buried with those sins. And the third day rose again to have complete victory over death and sin. And now all who trust in him will not perish, but have eternal life. Romans 10:9 says, if you confess with your mouth that he is Lord, believe in your heart that Jesus has risen from the dead, you'll be saved. So the truth of the matter is mankind has sinned, all of us. Because of that sin, we're separated from a holy God. But that holy God demonstrated his loves and his holiness. He was born of a virgin, God in the flesh, and died on the cross for us. So that's the relation, that's true salvation. And in chapter 2, he was trying to push this true salvation. If you look at verse 13, it says, he has made alive together with him. Made us alive together with him, having forgiven you of your trespasses. And we talked about the handwriting of requirements, verse 14, being nailed to the cross. And any other teaching is just a shadow or a picture. In fact, he talks about verse 23 of chapter 2, these things, works, doctrines of men, they have an appearance of wisdom, but they're self-imposed religion, and they have no value. There's no value to works. For by grace have you been saved through faith. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And so he ends chapter 2 talking about this self-imposed, man-invented religion that separates us from the grace of God, the mercy of Jesus Christ. Titus 3 says, not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but by the mercy of God, he has saved us. So what is true religion? And that's a word we trip up on, because Christianity is I never view it as a religion, but a relationship with Jesus Christ. But the Bible does have a definition for religion, and it's in James 1:26. It says this: if anyone thinks among you that he is religious, but does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this one's religion is useless. So a religion, and this is really where this meat of our lesson today is, while we are not saved by these works, in these verse 20 of chapter 2 calls them the regulations, do not touch, do not taste, do not handle, those type of things can't save you. You're not saved by works. However, James says, I will show you my faith through my works. So James says in James 1:26, pure religion that doesn't change a person, bridling his tongue, etc., it's kind of useless. Then he says in verse 27, pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this: to visit orphans and the widows in their trouble and keep oneself unspotted from the world. So a real pure religion, not look at the end of verse chapter 2, verse 23, false humility and self-imposed religion has no value. But a changed, transformed life, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed. A true born-again believer will have visible experiences, invisible examples, invisible proofs of their faith. You'll see it. And those things will be in two manners, according to James 1:27. One, you'll visit the orphans and widows, so you'll be a servant. You'll be one who is now giving of their life, a life that is a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. And two, you'll keep one unspotted from the world. You will begin to add to your faith virtue. You'll begin to put off those things which are sinful, and you'll begin to live a more Christ-like life. We're going to talk about that today in detail. So while works don't save you, doing the works of God, keeping his commandments, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments, they produce a spiritual maturity in a believer. And so there needs to be changes. There's things we need to put off and things we need to put on. And that's what chapter 3 is all about. It's the thing, it's changing your perspective, putting off those things that are detrimental, the unspotted from the world verses, and putting on the things of Christ. And so what we're going to do with these studies is we're going to look at only the first 11 verses today. And these are the things he kind of says you need to get rid of. And then in the last part of chapter 3 is the things you need to add. So these things, we're going to see the words put off. And that means to just take off, just like you're taking off a jacket or a coat, and things you need to put on. So let's look at this chapter. It's quite good. It says, if then you were raised with Christ, or that word if can be replaced with since you, but more not a thing of doubt, or if, but it does fit here. But if you're truly a Christian, or since you're a Christian, and you're raised with Christ, then we should seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. Set your affections or set your mind on things above and not on things of the earth. So let's look at the very first major change in a Christian's life. And that is an eternal view of the world and of the universe. All of a sudden, our affections are on things above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. That's quite a picture, isn't it? Well, Romans 8 describes it this way. It's beautifully written. Romans 8, verse 31. What shall we say then to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? I really like that. Verse 32, he who did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? So, you know, when we pray for things like financial help or health or well-being, we're praying to a God who's already given us the greatest gift of all. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him will never perish, but have everlasting life. What a God we have. Verse 33, who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It's God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It's God who, Christ who died and furthermore is risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. It says elsewhere in Romans 8 that the Holy Spirit also makes intercession for us. And so we have God at the, Jesus at the right hand of God, making intercession for us. We have Satan, the Bible says, who accuses us all day long. And yet it's Jesus who justifies. It's Jesus who died for us. It's Jesus who rose again. It's Jesus who has nailed those requirements to the cross. It's Jesus who died and was buried and rose again. So set our affections on the one you can trust, the one who's on your side. And if he is for you, who can be against you? So we set our complete mindset on Christ and not of this earth. And this is what's called like a carnal Christian or a worldly Christian, in which you're so wrapped up into the things of this world that you forget you're just ambassadors. You're just passing through. That our affections, our mindset, our sacrifice, our attention needs to be on the one who's at the right hand of God, completely on your side, completely for you. And if he's completely for you, who can be against you? There are two mindsets that are go on in the world today that will determine your happiness, your peace. The mindset of this world and how things are going, and the mindset of eternity and what is coming and who's in charge. Turn, if you will, to Ecclesiastes chapter 1. It's in the Old Testament, Psalms, Proverbs, and Ecclesiastes. And Ecclesiastes was written by Solomon. God gave wisdom above all men. And he writes about the vanity of life under the sun. And he writes this in chapter 1 of Ecclesiastes in verse 3. What profit has a man from all of his labor in which he toils under the sun? This is important. His perspective is not one of setting his affections on things above. He has been tasked by God to actually look at the world under the sun and analyze it, so to speak. And he says, what profit has a man from his labor in which he toils under the sun? Well, what is the profit of a life without a God attention philosophy? Well, verse 4, one generation passes away, another comes, but the earth abides forever. The sun rises, the sun goes down, hastens to the place where it rose. The wind goes toward the south and turns around in the north to the wind, whirls about continually, and it comes again on its circuit. And so he says in verse 2, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. So he looks at life under the sun and he says, you know, it's just a continual cycle of vanity, uselessness. He says in verse 7, all rivers run to the sea, but the sea's not yet full. The place from which the rivers come, they go again. And again, they're full of labor. Man cannot express it. The eye is not satisfied with seeing, nor the ear filled with hearing. That which has been is what will be. That which is done is what will be done. There's nothing new under the sun. Is there anything of which it may be said, see, this is new? It's already been in ancient times before us. There's no remembrance of former things, nor will there be anything remembered that are to come by those that come after. And he says, look, it's just a cycle. It's a rat race. It is vanity. It's just vanity. What man toils under the sun. Verse 12, he says, I, the preacher, was set king over Israel. I set my heart to seek and search out wisdom concerning all that is done under heaven. This is a burdensome task given to sons of men by which they may be exercised. I have seen the works that are done under the sun, and indeed all is vanity and grasping at the wind. He describes life under heaven, under the sun, watching people live their lives, not knowing Jesus Christ, not knowing that God created them, not knowing there's an eternal purpose. And it's just a rat race. It's just vanity. It's grasping at the wind. What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? But look at the difference in chapter 3 of Ecclesiastes, verse 9. He starts in the same manner, the same context. What profit has the worker from that which he labors? Well, we already saw that, isn't it? It profits you nothing. It's vanity. But look what he says in verse 10 of chapter 3 of Ecclesiastes. I've seen the God-given tasks the sons of men are to be occupied. He has made everything beautiful in its time. Well, now he's kind of contradicting himself. Now things are beautiful. What has changed? Well, look at what he says. He has put eternity in their hearts, except that no one can find out the work that God does from beginning to end. So we even though we look through a glass darkly, because we have eternity in our hearts, we see the world beyond the sun. We set our affections on things above. And because of that, verse 12 says, I know that nothing is better for them with eternity in their heart than to rejoice and do good in their lives. Also that every man should eat, drink, and enjoy the good of his labor. It is a gift of God. See, a man that does not know Jesus can toil and work his whole life. Ecclesiastes goes on to say, and yet they can build an empire, and yet they have to leave it to someone who could destroy it. And we've seen empires come and go, but the empire of Christ, the kingdom of God, is eternal. And so when we labor, it has an eternal purpose, and it has a meaning and a purpose for God, and it's a gift of God to enjoy life. John 10:10, I come to give you life and to give it to you more abundantly. So if you look at the end of Ecclesiastes, which is Ecclesiastes 12, last two verses of the book, Solomon writes, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. He says, okay, I have analyzed life under the sun, and here's my conclusion. Here's the meaning of life, the wisest man who ever walk this earth other than Christ says this: fear God and keep his commandments. This is the whole duty of man, or this is man's all. For God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil. So here's the conclusion. If you're going to live this life under the sun, live it for the God who is above the sun. Set your affections on things above and not on things on this earth. Because everything on the earth without God, without Christ, is vanity. It's here today and gone tomorrow like a vapor. It flies through. But a life lived for Christ has eternal meaning and eternal purpose. Let's go back to Colossians. So set your mind on those things above. Look what it says in verse 3. For if you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God, for you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. What a great verse. So this is a kind of an interesting meaning of this verse 3. For you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. The idea that you died is Romans 6. In fact, let's read through this. It's this spiritual death. Remember, we have been born again. To be born again, it means that your old nature, your old man, your old self has died. And so when you are physically baptism, it's a picture of the fact that you were once walking in selfishness and sin under the sun, not recognizing anything above the sun. And yet then you discovered, or Christ discovered you and raised you up, who were dead in your trespasses and sin, and made you alive. And now when you surrendered your life to Christ, the old John Flanagan is now dead and buried, as Christ died and buried with our sins. And we are now raised to walk in newness of life. Look at Romans 6, chapter 1. What shall we say then? Or verse 1, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Okay, now that I'm saved, can I just do whatever I want? No, certainly not. God forbid. How shall we, he died to sin, live any longer in it? Do you not know, as many of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus, that's saved, were baptized into his death? Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in newness of life. So that spiritual baptism is a new life. Your old person you used to be is gone. That's why James says, I'll show you my faith by my works, because he's a different person. We're new creatures. Look at verse 5 of Romans 6. For if you've been united and together in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. See, there's the difference in a Christian's life. It's not that you're sinless, but you should sin less. And when you sin, it should bother you more. And it should be your goal to walk away from that sin and not to be slaves to it. Look at verse 7. For he who died has been freed from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. Galatians 2:20, Paul says, it's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And that's really what this lesson is all about. When you come to the realization that you have a divine creator that lives above the sun, and you set your affections on him above the earth, above the sky, then your life on the earth will be different. It will be evidently different. So if we go back to Colossians chapter 3, for you died and your life is hidden with Christ. That's that buried with Christ. And that word hidden, there was a teaching in this time in Colossae. And we saw this sometimes in the early Catholic Church too, in which the leaders believe they have some hidden knowledge that only they know, that they've been given some divine spiritual awakening. And so they would use this word, this Greek word for hidden, to describe how the knowledge from God is hidden within them. And yet Paul turns it around and said, no, the knowledge is not hidden in us. We are hidden in Christ. It also is a picture of what we look like on the outside, our real spiritualness. Many will say, Lord, Lord, and Jesus say, I never knew you. So we look through a glass darkly, but look at the verse 4. It says, but when Christ, who is our life, appears, then you will also appear with him in glory. So we won't know for sure those who are truly his until he returns. You can be assured in your own life. I know that I'm saved. I have the blessed assurance of God. You may think I'm not. Many people think I'm not because of things I did 30 years ago. But I know that if I died today, I'd be absent from the body and present with the Lord. I know that because of what the Bible teaches. I know that Jesus is Lord, and I believe he's risen from the dead. I talk to him. Oh, when I sin, I confess it to him. Why? Because he's in charge of my life. And when I talk to him, I know that he sees everything I do. When I sin, whether it's in private or public, I feel terrible, and I go to God to forgive me, even when I'm by myself. So if I'm not a Christian, the Bible's a lie. So when Christ, who is our life, and that's the key. You know, we have people say, well, music is my life, or baseball is my life, or art is my life, or Jesus is your life. And if you're a Christian and Jesus is not your life, I don't know what to tell you, except you're missing out. You're selling yourself short, so to speak, in your Christian walk. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5:14, love of Christ compels us, because we judge thus that if one died for all, then all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. Present your body as a living sacrifice. Be transformed by loving the world, not conformed. Philippians 1:21, Paul says, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. But if I live in the flesh, this will mean fruit from my labor. I look at Don Clinton and Larry Milliken, two elders of this church who have been here since it started. And they're both, you know, growing towards the end of their ministries, and yet they're still strong in the ministry. Don continues this ministry of texting verses. He has a group that many that don't go to church, and he texts them verses every day. Larry is currently involved in ministry to the church, and he's working on, we're trying to set up a local radio station that will be able to play sermons from local pastors and verses and music throughout La Grande, Planada, and Plainsburg. And he's working hard setting that up. They haven't stopped, because there will be fruit from my labor. Even to the end of their days, they'll be ministering. Why? Because they're changed. It's not phony. It's not fake. Jesus Christ is their life. So is he part of your life, or is he your whole life? A life dedicated to God. So verse 5 of Colossians, we'll kind of close quickly on these, starts with the word therefore. So since, look at, if you're going to live for Christ and he's going to be your entire life, and you're going to die to your old self and live anew, therefore you should put to death your members which are on the earth. And those members are your body. If you lose a finger, you've been dismembered. The Bible says in Romans 6, therefore do not let, verse 12, sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey its lust. So there's warnings of that, that this is Romans 6, where we're talking about walking in newness of life. And one way is to not let sin reign in your mortal body. We're going to have stumbles. We're going to get up, set on a solid rock. And there's a secret to this, and it's in Romans 6:13. Do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin. Don't use your body for sexual sins, for physical sins, for things we'll talk about in a second. But present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. Let me encourage you. if you're struggling with the sins of the flesh and those type of things, one of the keys to it is to get the members into some type of service for God. Do something, whether it's your own children at home, whether it's involved in ministries at the church, whether it's involved in ministries that aren't, but do something with those members. Idleness is the devil's playground, someone once said. And so be careful. Why? Verse 14 says, for sin shall not have dominion over you, for you're not under the law, but under grace. So sin, you're no longer under the penalty of sin. So what shall we do? Continue in sin? No. That grace may abound? No. We're new creatures. We should live differently. And therefore, we want to put to death the members which are on the earth. We want to take our members, our mouth and our body, and use them for things that are edifying to God and to the church, and not those that are selfishly edifying. And he begins to list some of these things in verse 5. And verse 5 through 7 are physical sins with your body. And verses 8 through 9 are with your mouth. And so remember, everything in the world, all sins are lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and pride of life. And he says this, fornication, uncleanness, this is verse 5, passion, evil desire, covetousness, which is idolatry. All of those things, if you go to the Greek, are sexually focused. And we know that the flesh, the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. And sexual sins, even within the body of Christ, they are very prevalent in the world today. And much of that is because of two main reasons. We're not setting our affections on things above. Our members are not being used as righteousness. And in our idleness, we're being bombarded with all type of sexual scenery within movies and entertainment and internet. And because of that, our flesh is weak. And so what happens, he says, look, you need to back away from these sexual sins, these fornications and uncleanness, passion, covetousness, which is idleness. And that word covetousness is just, I don't have enough. And that's the problem with pornography and sexual sin. It never satisfies. There's always something you got to get. You got to go to a different place. And that leads to a lot of the sexual deviancy we have today, along with the principles of Romans 1, if you read that. But it's a pretty prevalent thing in our society today. And it's because God is just not a part of everything. God is, not only is God not their life, God's not any part of their life. But for a Christian, if God is a small part of your walk, you will be just as susceptible to these things as anybody else. Why? Because these things, verse 6, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience, in which you self once walked when you lived in them. So I became a Christian when I was 19. And there was not a moral compass back in those days, in my junior high school days. And you want to be different. You want to walk away from those things. But if you read Romans 7, you know those things of the flesh, they'll tug at you, and you've got to stay spiritually focused. Set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth. The earth drives you away. So those are the lusts of the flesh. Pride of life kind of comes with the covetousness a little bit, but also verse 8, but now you yourselves are to put off, and that we're going to look at that word. So it says put to death in verse 5. Verse 8 talks about putting off or taking off these things: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you put off the old man with his deeds. That old man goes back to Romans 6. We shouldn't be acting the way we acted before we were a Christian. And that was filthy language. That was a big deal for me. Played sports in high school. I had a filthy mouth. I had a terrible temper. All of that was born for selfishness. I was taught about my temper years ago about this principle of rights being violated. You know, the Bible says to yield your rights, yield yourself to God. And so my anger would be pride. You know, for example, this is a silly illustration, but it fits. If I had a piece of cake that I was saving in the refrigerator, and I went to get that piece of cake, and somebody had eaten it, back in the day, I'd flip my lid, you know, and be angry and slam the. And what, where did my anger come from? Well, I had a right to that cake. But if you yield your rights to God, and that helped me with my anger, with coaching and things like that, that I had a right, that was an unfair call, or that was unfair, that's not right. So it was all pride. And so being able to set my affections on things above, in which I yield my rights and to God and trust in the sovereignty of God. And if God wanted me to have the piece of cake, I'd have had the piece of cake. And I've had 1,000 pieces of cake since then. You know what I mean? So those are the things that begin to change in us. So those are things we're to put off those things of the mouth, the tongue that James talks about, that fiery serpent of a tongue, and put off the lust of the flesh. Well, we can't do that unless we put on the things of Christ, which is what we're going to talk about next week. So verse 10, let's close with these verses. He says, so we have put on the new man. So we put off the things of the flesh. We get rid of them. You say, well, I really struggle when I go on the internet. I just fall into pornography. Well, then maybe you need to stay off the internet. You see, we've got to work on putting those things off and getting rid of them. And it's not easy. It's not as simplistic as we make it out to be. But if you will set your affections on things above, be in prayer, be in the Word, you will see those things do begin to be easier to handle, and God takes care of them. You don't want to do them. God doesn't want you to do them. And so God will work with you. And we put on the new man, who is renewed in knowledge according to the image of him who created him. What a beautiful verse. So this is the idea, that through the knowledge of God, add to your faith virtue, virtue knowledge, we begin to be more like Christ, who created us in the image of God. And now that we have been reconciled to God, a life in church, a life in study, a life in prayer, a life in service to him, you will begin to look and act more like him. The image of God will begin to be visible in your walk. And never glorified here on earth, that's coming, but never using that as an excuse to sin. But we begin through the knowledge. Remember, the Bible says that we are not to be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of our mind. Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. So we begin to grow through the study and knowledge of God. And then we begin to become the image of our Creator. I like verse 11, where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, size barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and in all. See, when you make Christ everything, Christ begins to live in you, Galatians 2:20. And when Christ begins to live in you, we begin to see a similarity of Christians who are really 100% living for Christ. There's a similarity. If you've ever met somebody, I always give the example of a family who came to the bowling alley one Saturday. And usually when families come to the bowling alley, there's usually turmoil, and Sally didn't get her, hot dog, and Johnny didn't get his French fries, and they're mad and crying. And this family was having the loveliest time. They were happy and they were joyful, and And so they came up, and I was working the desk at the time, and they paid. And I said, "Can I ask you a question?" I said, "Are you Christians?" And he says, "Yes." "How did you know?" And I just knew. I could tell they had this image of them, of a family that only Christ could be interjected in, so to speak, because that's what it says. 2 Corinthians 5:17, "Therefore, if any of us is in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things have passed away, all things have become new." Verse 18, 2 Corinthians 5, "Now all things are of God. He's our whole life." Colossians 3, 4, "When Christ, who is our life, appears, is he your whole life?" If he's your whole life, you got to get rid of those things of the flesh. You got to get away from those things of the flesh. Take them off. Get rid of them. Oh, do the things you need to do to remove the temptations from your life. Remove those things that cause you to stumble, and allow God to work through you through study and prayer, fellowship of believers, serving God in some manner of way with your instruments, the members of your instruments. Then you will become more like him. You won't become as like him until we get to heaven, but we become more like him. So we talked about the things to put off. If you look at verse 12 of Colossians, it says, "Therefore, as elect of God, holy and beloved, put on." So next week we talked about not the things we're taking off. We're going to talk about the things that we need to add to our Christian walk. And not all of them are easy, but take this walk day by day, every day, living more for him and becoming more like him. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this incredible mercy and patience that you have, the long suffering that you have as you wait for us, Lord, to take the steps to become more like you. Heavenly Father, the answer is very simple, that Christ should be all in all, that Christ should be our life. Our affections and our mindset should be on things above, and we need to get our minds off of ourself and on this world. Lord, help us to do these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, let's pray for each other. We all need help in these areas. The Spirit is willing. We all want to do these things. We want to be more like God, but it takes some work. And just pray that you'll be successful in this. God bless you.